subject for today's lecture is development. So, the development starts when egg meets sperm. And what you have on this picture is a consecutive stages. It's the same sperm, by the way. It's not like four different sperms. It's like step one, then what happens, then next step, and next step. And let's start from the very beginning. First of all, remember that the egg is huge. So where the egg is before it meets sperm. The name of organ of female reproductive system is, okay, it's in ovaries. In the ovaries, there are a bunch of follicles. What is a follicle? It's where the primary oocyte becomes actually an egg by going through divisions of reproductive system that are called that is called meiosis. Why do we need meiosis? So what happened? Well, how is it different from mitosis?
It's split so that it has less chromosomes.
Yes, in the egg we need less chromosomes. We need just one copy of each chromosome, not two copies of each chromosome, as every other cell of the body has. So, primary follicle, the first division of meiosis, secondary follicle, second division of meiosis. At the end, very, very huge egg. Egg is the biggest cell of the body, normally, a chicken egg, or caviar, fish egg, or female egg. Why is that so big? Because the sperm is way too small. Sperm carries only DNA. Egg will carry, this is the nucleus with DNA, but egg will carry everything that is necessary for division, for the first series of divisions. So it has a lot of mitochondria, of course. It has a lot of different enzymes already stored here. Producing an egg is a very expensive biological mechanism. So it's a very, very precious cell. Now, DNA. Of nuclear DNA, of course, is in the nucleus. Now we have mitochondria located in cytoplasm. Mitochondria will give an energy for the developing cell. And according to one of the theories, mitochondria, long time ago, was a foreign organism that our cells just gobbled up and made it work for us. And mitochondria have their own DNA. And guess what? It was shown that sometimes your energy, your appearance, your longevity depends on the work of your mitochondria. And there are a bunch of studies studying mitochondrial DNA, where it came from, and how efficiently it's able to produce energy. You probably know the Jewish tradition that if the mother is Jewish, the child is Jewish. If just the father is Jewish and mother is not Jewish, so the child is not considered Jewish. mitochondrial inheritance. We're not gonna study mitochondrial inheritance in this course, but just remember that one of the aging theories is that the genes that are responsible for our longevity are located in mitochondria. Okay, so female reproductive system is very busy building an egg, collecting, you know, with the first division of meiosis, there are two cells. One is really small, the other is bigger. The bigger survives, collects all the cytoplasm, the smaller dies. Then the second division of meiosis, one is big, the other one is small, smaller dies. So this is the cell that collected all the cytoplasm, that kind of uneven division of meiosis. And when it is kicked out of the ovary into oviduct, this is a process of ovulation, it also takes with it a bunch of smaller so-called follicular cells. These are surrounding cells that were nourishing the egg in the follicle, in the ovaries, and now they are kind of stuck here. And this layer is called corona radiata. Does the egg need it? Not really. But what the egg really needs is a special layer that is right here. See, it's a white, thick, looks like membrane, but it's not a membrane. It's kind of, you know, can't say goo or something. It's a layer of protein, layer of some kind of material protecting the egg. Now we have 6-7 million sperm coming to fertilize an egg. And of course, Y chromosomes are a little bit faster, X chromosomes are a little bit slower, depending on the time and the proportion of the X and Y chromosomes, there's a boy or the girl. Usually, there's a small, the percentage of the boys are just a little bit higher than the percentage of the girls being born. Well, anyway, fertilization happens in the oviduct. That's the idea, because if it happens in, you know, the where fimbria of the oviduct hold the egg, there's a small distance, a small gap, and if an egg, fertilized egg, escapes into this gap, it's very unpleasant abdominal pregnancy. So fertilization happens in the oviduct, and while ovulation is the exit of the egg from the ovary, fertilization is egg plus sperm equals zygote. This is the process. This, well, fertilization. Remember the word zygote. What is drawn here? Here is the sperm pushing through by using its mitochondria that are located right here, pushing through the follicular cells and getting into zona pellucida. In zona pellucida, this cap covering the DNA of the sperm dissolves, because now sperm kind of have to eat through that. And it needs the digestive enzymes that are stored in the acrosome. You can see here, it's the same sperm, it's not five different ones. It's through, it's a competition. The first sperm to eat through the zona pellucida and touch the cell membrane of the egg wins, because at that moment, zona pellucida solidifies and prevents all other sperms from fertilizing the egg. So they kind of, you know, die in zona pellucida that now turn into concrete. The other ones. But this one, as you can see, the first one, it comes into the egg, releases DNA. DNA of the sperm merges with DNA of the egg, and the egg, which is no longer is no longer called an egg, but zygote, gets an ability to divide. Not before that moment. Only when you have, when finally DNA of the mother and DNA of the father will join together in the nucleus, then zygote can divide. Okay, now let's... So, this is a slide that is on your blackboard. Remember, corona radiata, zona pellucida, and zona pellucida is there to prevent fertilization of the same egg by multiple sperm. Now, the process of development starts. And in this slide, four processes of development are listed. They are kind of mixed with each other in development. So the development itself starts with cleavage. What is cleavage? Let's find another picture in the book. No, I need this picture right on the next page. Let me find the slide with this picture. This one. So, what you see here is a zygote. And then a special division, cleavage, starts. What is cleavage? Cleavage is just replicating DNA and quickly splitting all the cytoplasm in half. How cleavage is different from mitosis? Mitosis includes growth. Growth, you know, after replicating DNA, the cell divides, then there is some time where cell accumulates different materials, rebuilds the necessary amount of cytoplasm, then divides again. Cleavage is only about DNA replication and then splitting the cytoplasm, and splitting the cytoplasm again, and splitting the cytoplasm again. Well, each round with doubling the DNA. Why do we need it? Why do we need to convert one huge zygote into the bunch? Of much smaller cells. No, it's a ball of cells at the end. Because as you can see, the oviduct diameter is the same. And cells are building material, so we need a lot of building material, but at that point, we need kind of a lot of cells, but not of a big size, so the cell won't get stuck in the oviduct, but makes it to the uterus, right here. And what you see on this picture, this is the oviduct. This is, of course, corpus luteum, which is the place where the egg has been. And these pictures show you what happens with the zygote while the zygote moves down the oviduct. As you can see, it's a process of cleavage, which is increasing the number of cells, division, increases the number of cells without increasing the cytoplasm. And we see morula here. Morula in the next stage, stages of cleavage are very simple. 2-cell stage, 4-cell stage, then 8-cell stage. Finally, we cannot count. When we cannot count the cells, it's morula, it's a ball of cells, and then blastula, when all cells move to the sides and all of a sudden we have hollow surface inside of this ball of cells. In this, now note the position right here. Already in the uterus. Uterus is an organ that specially designed for carrying fetus to term. So what is the name of this lining, special crucial lining? Endometrium. Now, when this blastula, or in human we call it blastocyst, touches the endometrium, it kind of roots itself there, grows roots and secures itself in the uterus. And what is placenta? Here's the uterus, here's the lining, here's the blastocyst. Immediately, kind of grows into endometrium, and the area right here, not exactly belonging to the uterus, and not exactly belonging to the embryo, is the placenta. As soon as placenta is formed, it starts to produce HCG, human chorionic hormone. It goes in maintenance corpus luteum there, which cancels the development of the other cells, eggs in the ovaries. All right, up to this point, it's the first stage of development, which is called pre-embryo. On pre-embryonic stage of development, a woman can lose it, and pregnancy starts from the point when pre-embryo implants itself in the uterus and starts embryonic stage of development, which lasts from the second week to the end of second month. Just remember, choo-choo-choo. And then we'll have fetal stage of development, development of the fetus. The last one includes life and aging, which is also this kind of development. So what's interesting in here? Artificial insemination, egg meets sperm in a petri dish, then it goes through cleavage, just like in the oviduct, creating more and more cells. When we have enough of cells, we can take one of those cells from a petri dish and check it for different disease, sex of the future fetus, and so on. Check for everything. And then if parents like what they see, this thing can be implanted directly into uterus. Usually they implant 2-3. Some people probably remember like Octomom that got plenty of this eggs implanted, and then she got octoplets, 8 babies. That was kind of a while back. It was a huge discussion because the mom wasn't like particularly wealthy, so there was like a bunch of ethical discussions. But anyway, the ethical question here is what to do with those embryos. They can be like frozen or, you know, what to do with them. So is it a person or not a person? Where human life starts and so on. And that was one of the first ethical problems of designer babies, genetic engineering, where exactly is the beginning of human life, where we treat a person as a person and where it is just a bunch of cells. So a lot of religious leaders were asked, what is a human life, finally? And some of them said, only when a particular ball of cells gets implanted in the uterus, but Catholic Church said when it's, the egg is being fertilized, so U.S. stopped all genetic engineering with stem cells, because stem cells come from original stem cells, embryonic stem cells, come from these cells, because at that stage, those cells can become any cell in the body. Then later on, they become differentiated. Some genes will be permanently shut down, and it will take much more years of research to reactivate those stem cells, and we still don't know what I'm working with, because there were a lot of like lies. People will say that we produced these stem cells from like skin cells. In reality, they were like embryonic stem cells, and that's one of the scientific squabbles over time. Anyway, these cells are have the potency to become anything in the body. They were the primary source of the embryonic stem cell. So let's move on and discuss embryonic development. Okay, so let me see. So far we discussed cleavage. Now, which happens in pre-embryonic development. Now, embryonic development is the most important stage of development because of so-called morphogenesis means that the bunch of cells that we created on the stage of pre-embryonic development starts to make folds and migrates and migrate and create a lot of like folded structure. So the structure becomes more complex. And at that time, the blueprint of the body is laid down. So cells are going to find themselves in relative position to each other and then can activate certain genes. And in this communication, they decide which part of the embryo will become muscles, which part will become brain, which part will become nervous system or gut. And if a mother at that stage get a certain kind of virus disease, so that's why abortion is recommended, because it's the blueprint. It's the blueprint of the body, of the whole body of a new person. If something goes wrong there, there's not a chance of correcting it later on. So in most cases, a baby with changed plan, blueprint, probably this pregnancy won't be carried to term. But it's a very, very fragile and dangerous stage of development. In this stage, mother should take very, very careful, it's probably later in the chapter, very careful care about herself, not to smoke, not to drink. But as you can see, some mothers don't even know that they may be pregnant in this stage. So the good lifestyle kind of good prevention for everything. Okay. Now, week 2, embryonic development. Pregnancy begins after implantation. Human chorionic gonadotropin, this is human chorionic hormone, is secreted, maintaining the corpus luteum. Corpus luteum maintains endometrium, and then placenta will get the ability to produce its own progesterone to maintain the placenta, so corpus luteum could be disintegrated later on. Now, what else should we know about this stage. First of all, there are four so-called membranes, which are not a part of the embryo and not part of the uterus. Some kind of helpful structures for developing baby. The inner cell, the outside of the embryo is so-called chorionic membrane. Chorion makes placenta, because chorionic villi are those roots that will implant itself in the endometrium. Now, what only a small bunch of cells right here will create embryonic disc. This is our future person. Everything else are supporting structures that are created from the same ball of cells. Now, embryonic disc, it's like primary fold, and it creates ecto and endo at the beginning, endoderm, ectoderm on top of the endoderm, and mesoderm, something in between. From this three primary layers, we get the majority of the organs. As you could see, here is everything in detail. Okay, this picture. The majority of organs, this is picture, again, it's in your book on page 394. Look at mesoderm. Skeleton, muscular system, dermis of skin, cardiovascular system, like everything from middle layer. From ectoderm, it's just your skin plus nervous system. Remember that your nervous system and your skin have the same origin. And endoderm will create just the lining of your gut. Look at that picture. This is an embryo at week 5. Doesn't look like a human, but it's my favorite picture. It's called, this is from the time when we were dinosaurs. Remember, there's a dinosaur in you. And guess where your six-pack is located? Six-pack of a human. See that white stuff? These are your future muscles. And that's what we inherited from worms, a segmentary stage of development. Then they're called somites at that stage, but then they will develop into your biceps and triceps and abs and everything. Now, look at the brain. Huge ball. Here's also a heart that starts beating and a nervous system that is already laid down. Remember that the first system that is detectable, that develops in the embryo, is a nervous system. Cardiovascular system is the second one. Okay, nervous system is week 3. And the question is, why nervous system and your skin has the common ancestor? Just because nervous system, here's a layer, meso, let's say ecto on top, meso in the middle, endo down below. The nervous system will be created by invagination of the top layer, like inside, like creating a fold. This fold just going inside of the embryo. In a certain stage, nervous system will get separated from your skin cells. And this is your spinal cord. So this process is called neurulation. Three. And development of the heart begins. Fourth week. Umbilical cord forms, limb buds, our arms and legs start to grow. Okay, weeks 6 to 8, the end of embryonic period. Embryo begins to look like a human being. Reflex actions occur. Remember reflexes? All organ systems have been established. And it's 1.5 inches, so 8 millimeters is just 1.5 inches by the end of this period and wait. And remember, all systems are established. So the fetal stage of development is mostly about growing and doing fine-tuning of the embryo. So it's less crucial than embryonic stage of development. Months 3 or 4. Wait a minute. I would like to speak a little bit about the process of development. We already discussed cleavage. Let's look at your vocabulary. Cleavage, division without growth. Actually, let's start from the very beginning of the vocabulary. Zygote. Who remembers what zygote is? Your goal here is to characterize it in minimal words with maximum sense. Yes. Yes, fertilized egg or sperm plus egg, zygote. First cell of a new baby. Now, zona pellucida, a layer of material that will solidify when first sperm gets into the egg. Corona radiata, it's follicular cells surrounding the neck.
What kind of cells?
Follicular. Cells from ovaries, just much smaller cells. Now, there are three stages of development. They're actually like four, but we are considering the development from zygote, if we consider the development from zygote to birth. So pre-embryonic, it's first 2 weeks, embryonic, second week to the end of second month, and fetal stage. What I recommend you to remember is the time of embryonic development. 2 to 2, second week to second month. Then everything else becomes very clear. End of second month to birth and pre-embryonic first 2 weeks when the egg, when fertilized egg is moving through the oviduct. Cleavage. Division without growth. Morphogenesis. Cell migration. Creating folds. Well, cell migration and laying the blueprint of organs. That is morphogenesis. Differentiation, it's about each particular cell choosing its destiny, occupations, So which cells that cells are differentiated when each particular cell is just a nervous cell or muscular cell and cannot be and lose all its potential to become somewhere else. Specialization of the cells. Now growth, let's put it as replicating DNA and getting bigger, right? Growth and cleavage are here to compare. Cleavage is a division without growth, and normal growth. It says a mitosis, if you remember what mitosis is, or division by mitosis, when cells grow inside. Okay, embryonic disc has three germ layers. This is ecto, meso, and endoderm. And there are four embryonic membranes. All of the names of the embryonic membranes came from chickens, but you can find them in the human as well. Chorion. Chorion is the first membrane. Remember, embryonic disc is somewhere like right here. Here's all chorion. Chorion makes placenta. Now, amnion, amniotic fluid or waters. It's kind of a fold. It starts like a fold. It's not. We think about membrane as enveloping something, but it's just a structure that contains amniotic fluid and cushions the baby. Now, allantois will give rise to umbilical cord. We all know that these structures are not the baby and not the mother, but kind of in between. And yolk sac. It contains many blood vessels and of course it's much smaller in humans than in chickens, and it's the place of first blood cells formation. Because there's no bone marrow at that point, so the first blood forms in yolk sac, like right here. Remember, there's no bone marrow yet. When we move to fetal development, yeah, see all these membranes you can find on this picture in your book. Placenta made by chorion. Then you see yolk sac, allantois, umbilical cord, and the cavity with water. Okay, let's move to fetal development. Hair develops. Cartilage begins to be replaced by bone. Remember, endochondral and intramembranous ossification. Once again, it's a lot of cartilage left at the, in the baby, fontanelle. On baby's head, there's all cartilage at the point of birth. Now, there is a difference between male and female. You can hear the heartbeat. And later on, there is a movement produced. Fetal size increases. Fingers will form. Then, months 8 and 9, huge weight gain by the baby. Rotation, and remember that lungs are being prepared for by producing surfactant, so the lungs won't stick together when baby is born. And then birth. Birth defects. fetal circulation. Lungs are not working yet. And such a important realization that baby is swimming in water, amniotic fluid, which are the same time kind of baby's urine and water. And all the exchanges are done through placenta, umbilical cord and placenta. Now, development of sex organs. We all know that double X, having two chromosomes, is female. And XY is male. Why the Y chromosome is so important? Because it has SRY regions, sex determinant region on Y chromosome, and this gene will start working at week 6. Before that, remember that the default is a female. And on page 399, there is a picture of reproductive systems of male and female, which are at that stage are totally identical. This one. This picture. Six weeks, right here. Y chromosome. Okay. See testes, ovaries. See how similar they are, those reproductive systems. At 6 weeks, if a person has SRY gene, it will produce anti-Müllerian hormone, and it will cancel the development, it will cancel female reproductive system development. If this gene, for example, if a person has Y chromosome but this gene is not functioning, the default is female. The person will be female. Then, but it's only first hormone. We have another two. We have testosterone, which is produced by interstitial cells in the testes. And we have dihydrotestosterone, which is a hormone derived from testosterone, which directs the development of urethra, prostate gland, and scrot. So here's some couple of abnormalities of sex organs. We can talk about XY female syndrome. Okay, in this slide there's a mistake. An individual develops into not a male but female because a piece of the Y chromosome containing SRY gene is missing. This slide came with a book, and XY female syndrome, you will see female, which is a default, if this gene is not working. Or the person can have a genotype XX, but it develops into a male because of certain chromosome aberration. Part of Y chromosome somehow gets translocated to X chromosome. Now, we can keep in mind a certain androgen insensitivity syndrome. Remember endocrine system? Remember that first we have to have a hormone, And second thing, we have to have responsive cells. Target cells must have a receptor for these hormones to be responsive. So what happens in androgen insensitivity syndrome is the hormone, the testosterone is there, but the receptor, testosterone receptor is broken or insensitive, ineffective, and the testes do not descend. So testes are there, and a person appears to be female. In some cases, once again, if this hormone, testosterone itself, is absent because testes are not able to produce it, another thing can occur, and another thing is that the person looks like a female until puberty, and then at puberty it grows penis, because at puberty the other glands will start working, which are also able to produce the hydrotestosterone and testosterone. This is this is apparently in Caribbean region some high percentage prevalence of this abnormality. So pseudo is androgen insensitivity syndrome. This woman has testes, is just receptors are broken. This is the female default development. All right, in your lecture notes, I put a mention of all these three hormones that need to be working, not only hormones, but receptors to these hormones in order to produce a male. So to produce a male will take more biological effort than to produce a female. Mother's body, this birth, baby comes, then placenta comes, and let's say at the moment when baby is born, aging will start. There are three hypotheses of aging. First is genetic origin, and this genetic origin does not refer to nuclear DNA. It refers to mitochondrial DNA, which will direct mitochondrial activity, making mitochondria to produce more or less free radicals that are involved in aging. Then the next hypothesis, whole body processes, suggests that aging may be a result of from body systems wearing at once, and you can delay aging or speed up aging by getting involved in good or poor health habits, like choosing certain things to eat and liking exercise. Because by now we know how many hormones are activated by exercise, that our bone health depends on exercise, our digestive system depends on exercise. Animals, so they have to move for sure, like horses or dogs, to produce some kind of, defecation. That's why when the horse falls and not able to move, it dies from digestive system failure. So our digestion also will depend on exercise. And guess what? Lately it was shown that the food that we eat can activate or repress certain genes. So sure, we can have genes for everything, but your lifestyle will activate ones and repress the other ones. So you kind of shape your gene work by choosing your lifestyle. Now, what happens with the age? Skin become thinner, less elastic and dry. Collagen kind of gone. Now insulation is gone, the baby insulation. So elderly people will feel cold easily. Now melanocytes, leading to gray hair, age spots, so that's skin pigments, heart shrinks and arteries become more rigid. You can see that the aging will reflect changes in all system. Reaction time slows, senses are muted. So once again, think about those receptors and activation mechanisms. Now, lens in the eye lose ability to accommodate. Lens become more rigid, so glasses, nearsightedness develop. Blood pressure usually increases. See, arteries become more rigid and blood pressure increases. So bone density declines. Remember that at the age of Cauchy, the activity of osteoclasts will exceed the activity of osteoblasts, but you can increase the activity of osteoblasts by exercising. Muscle mass decreases because person not able to move and exercise muscle. Muscle tone decreases as well. Proprioceptors, those receptors that are located in the muscles, mechanoreceptors, also the sensitivity of those goes down, so it's harder to maintain posture. Remember stereocilia in your vestibular apparatus, stereocilia that keep our gravitational and rotational balance, they become less sensitive. And females go through menopause and males go through andropause. Basically, kind of similar thing. Well, health and lifestyle will help you get through all of it. That's it for today. Oh, did we finish the vocabulary? Okay, four embryonic membrane, carinal and toys, sac and amnion. SRY is a determinant region of Y chromosome. Okay, to develop as male, you need to have SRY gene and three hormones. Let's list them. Anti-Müllerin. Anti-M cancels the development of female organs. And then testosterone, which directs the development of internal sex organs. Like testes go somewhere into scrotum sac, development of all of this. And dihydrotestosterone, which is based on testosterone, but these are male external organs. Three hypotheses for aging. First is genetics of mitochondria. Second hypothesis, failing of all body systems, and the third hypothesis is the lifestyle influence. So that's how you can increase or decrease your aging. All right, I'll see you Wednesday. Thank you very much for coming.